Okay, I'm going to go ahead and do a brief introduction. People will probably keep trickling on. So I'm happy to briefly introduce David Stork, who is our speaker today. And David is currently a visiting professor at the Technical University of Vienna. Last semester and next semester, he's a visiting lecturer at Stanford. And as he mentioned to me before, he's held academic appointments in eight different and sometimes quite different academic disciplines, and actually had contact with SFI back in the early convent days. So, and some involvement in some of the early A-Life conferences. And he's written some very highly regarded books, including on pattern classification and seeing the light, optics, and nature, photography, color vision, and holography. He's working on a new book, which I believe we're going to be hearing about some of the content from that, and I guess is going to be reissuing pattern classification soon also. So, and David asks a little bit counter to what we normally do. He does ask people to hold their questions to the end and to refer to the slide when you ask your question. And you can ask your question any way you want to, after he's finished. And because probably some of your questions he may well answer already in the course of his talk. So David, take it away.
Thank you so much, Jen. It's a great pleasure to sort of be back at Santa Fe. So today I'm going to talk about when computers look at art. And when you stand back and look at the wealth of images we find in major museums, it's really quite astounding. These are some of the most important images ever created. They are highly, highly studied. But it's been only in the past decade or so that a small band of us, small but growing, have applied techniques from computer vision, machine learning, and artificial intelligence to answering questions about the history and interpretation of these masterpieces and great works. But even if you're not interested in art per se, but are interested in artificial intelligence, you should be interested in art, because art poses problems to AI that are not being covered by the vast majority of work that centers on photographs. For instance, art presents a wide range of styles in colors and forms and brush strokes and marks and so forth that you don't get in photographs. We have to deal with small data sets. Most current systems, AI systems in image analysis, involve hundreds of millions, sometimes over a billion photographs to train for object recognition, segmentation, and other tasks. Whereas an artist like Johannes Vermeer leaves us just 34 paintings. We don't have big data on these kinds of artworks. Art also contains non-realistic objects, like a watch that's dripping like molasses. You won't find this in any photographs for your training set. It also involves unphysical conventions, things like flying putti, the little naked babies that are flying in the sky. Again, you won't find those in the database. A profound problem for AI is understanding abstraction in art. There are meanings there, but they don't rely on recognizing objects and the typical foundations for understanding images that you get in traditional AI. But the most important difference between paintings and the vast, vast, vast majority of photographs that are used in AI research concerns meaning. Paintings are made by an artist or author, as we call them, often with a message or a moral or an idea that's being conveyed. And that really isn't being treated by traditional AI right now. And let me give you just one example of how AI, current AI, is not addressing this problem of meaning in art or in photographs. Here's a state-of-the-art deep neural network output on the problem of image segmentation. That is, deep network system was trained with hundreds of millions of photographs, and it can quite well segment the image into regions of sidewalk or person or vehicle or building and so forth. But this tells us nothing about why someone would make an image. So here's a painting in the National Gallery in London, and it's screaming meaning. It's overflowing with meaning. And current AI systems can indeed recognize the shell and the skull and the wine jug and the books and so forth. It can also compute simple predicates. The book is touching the skull. The watch is on the table and so forth. But that doesn't tell you at all why this image is prized, why the author made it, the artist made it, and how these objects and the composition and the style work together to create meaning. And the meaning of this painting, in a nutshell, it's from a genre called vanitas, from the Dutch Golden Age. And in a nutshell, the message would be, don't concern yourself with the pleasures of this life. Instead, leave a humble and sober life in preparation for the eternal life to come. And how does a painting like this convey that kind of meaning? Well, clearly the skull references mortality and death. The books represent worldly learning, and likewise the musical instruments, the pleasures of culture and the wine jug and so forth, the beautiful shell and the sword, which would have come from Japan at this time, refer to travel and worldly knowledge and so forth. But the watch on the table references time, and it's not just time like a stopwatch time. This is time of life, and showing that life, you know, your time on earth may, you know, is always passing. And the lamp in the background would have had a flame on it and referenced life, but that flame is out, and it's recently out. You can see the small stream of smoke, meaning that that flame just went out, which of course has references to the imminence of death. Moreover, we see this slash of light coming from the upper left, and that clearly has religious overtones of, and the fact that it's shining directly on the skull is to relate it just to you. And the style of this painting works for the towards its meaning. This is highly realistic. These artists of the, like Van Steenwijk, De Hoogh and others, tried to make things as realistic as possible so that the message was, this is here before you, this is real. If this were done in an impressionist style, it would have lost that kind of meaning. Moreover, the size of the painting is important. This is, I'll call it life size, to make, again, the objects seem real and here in front of you. If this were a little miniature or a wall mural, it would have lost this. So understanding the meaning of this is the kind of task that AI should try to address. And I'm going to show you some of our research work at the end of my talk as first steps for trying to infer a meaning in religious paintings, in fact. But back to the kinds of tools that we're developing that are helping art scholars. And I'll start with lighting. Here's Johannes Vermeer's incredible masterpiece, Girl with a Pearl Earring. And Vermeer was well known for his mastery in rendering the effects of light, the shadows on her cheek, the reflection off the pearl, her eyes, the moist lips and so forth. But if we were to ask the simplest technical question about the light in this painting, it would be, what's the direction of illumination? And if two art scholars disagreed, how would we adjudicate? Well, let me show you six techniques from computer vision that answer this question absolutely clearly, and then tell you how it changes our understanding of this painting and can be used elsewhere in the history of art. The six methods fall into two categories. Model independent methods are ones where we don't need to know or make any assumptions about the three-dimensional form of the object. We'll look at the cast shadow from her nose and what's called the occluding contour algorithm. And then the model dependent methods, where we do make some assumptions about the three-dimensional form. I'll make a 3D model of the pearl, of her eye, of her face, and then the entire tableau. So the simplest technique is cast shadow analysis. You don't even need a computer for it. You take a point on an occluder, its corresponding cast shadow point, draw a straight line with error bars, and you find the direction to illumination, the illuminant in the plane of the painting is 150 plus or minus 2 degrees, where throughout I'm going to measure angles with respect to the horizontal. The occluding contour algorithm takes the pattern of lightness along the outer boundary or occluding contour of an object and infers what direction of illumination best explains that pattern of lightness. But if I just measured the lightness at one patch, that gray patch, it's the brightness is determined by three things: the overall intensity of the light, the albedo or reflectivity of the object, is it black or white or gray, and the unknown direction theta between the normal and the direction to the illumination. So if I just give you that patch, I have one equation in three unknowns, you can't solve it. But if I measure many patches along the contour, then you can. You can set up a set of linear equations. Look at the middle patch, it's bright. It's probably facing towards the light. The ones at the edge are darker. They're probably pointing away from the light. I've published two papers on this before finding out that Leonardo da Vinci found this principle in 1498, not just qualitatively, but quantitatively. He was talking about the number of rays that struck a portrait at different angles so that he could paint them more accurately. We're using it to infer the illumination accurately. Here are some technical aspects about the assumptions, and here's the set of linear equations we have to solve. But we were the first to ever apply it to paintings. And what we found for The Girl with the Pearl Earring is the direction to the illumination is about 149 plus or minus 4 degrees. Then to the model dependent methods. I took a high resolution photograph of the pearl in that painting, and we can confidently assume that the pearl is cylindrically symmetric. So I built a wireframe computer graphics model. And then you texture map, you add the white surface to it. And a pearl has both specular and diffuse reflection. So you have to adjust by eye the relative contributions. But then in our computer graphics model, we can place the illuminant wherever we want, so as to render a pearl that matches that in the painting as accurately as possible. And now we have an estimate to the direction of illumination. Turns out to be 155 plus or minus 4 degrees. What about the highlights on her eyes? If her eye is red, the red sphere here, and the source of light is at some position, it's simple geometry. You have the angle of incidence equals angle of reflection, but all the light ray passes in, it stays within this plane tipped at some angle that goes through the source of illumination. And so on her eyes, we take a line from the green line from the center of the sphere, her eyeball, through the center of mass of the highlight, and that gives us an estimate to the direction of illumination. Turns out to be 150 plus or minus 2 degrees. The most sophisticated technique we used came from a branch of computer vision called shape from shading. If we had a three-dimensional model of her face, if we could find the direction of illumination on that model that best explains the pattern of lightness that we find in the actual painting. Problem is, we don't have a model of her face. So we did the next best thing. We took a generic model, it's actually of a man's face. We adjusted the pose to match the girl as accurately as possible, and then used shape from shading algorithms to infer a direction to the illumination. That gives us our initial light source estimate. But of course, it's not going to be correct because it's not the correct face. So then we held that light estimate constant and fixed the face. We adjusted the albedo over it or the depth, it's equivalent. And now we get a better model of her face. And now we can use that to re-estimate the direction to the illumination. And we cycle this. It only took two iterations and it settles down. And at the end, we get a direction, an estimate to the direction of illumination and a better model of her face. Those of you who do machine learning will recognize this as the GEM or generalized expectation maximization algorithm. And the algorithm gives us that the direction to the illumination is 160 plus or minus 5 degrees. Then we built a full 3D computer graphics model. Now, of course, this is an ill-posed problem going from 2D to 3D, but if you make some assumptions about the symmetry of her face and normal geometry and so forth, you can do this. And in a technical sense, any uncertainties add variance to our estimate, but they don't add any bias. They don't mean that our estimate for the light direction is going to be too high or too low. And that's fine, and we can incorporate that. So now we're, by the way, when I showed this at the Mauritshuis Museum in The Hague, the audience went crazy because they'd never seen the back of their painting. Anyway, I'm going to stop the motion of the light in the configuration that best matches the actual painting. And then we're going to fly around Vermeer's studio to look at it from lots of different directions. And we're going to stop in the configuration that best matches the actual painting. And then I'll do what's called an alpha blend from computer graphics, basically a blurring between the computer graphics model and the actual painting. And you'll see that it's remarkably accurate or has high fidelity. It matches really quite closely. So now here are three, think of them as stills from that movie with the light in different directions, one too low, one just right, and one too high. And in this way, we get another estimate to the direction of the illumination. Turns out to be 160 plus or minus 5 degrees. So here are our results that I just showed you. The average direction is 155 degrees, and that's actually not very interesting. What is interesting and very important is the extremely small standard deviation that we get from these, the remarkable agreement among the estimates from these different methods. Okay, so what? Why would an art scholar be interested in this? Well, this painting isn't a portrait. We don't know who this girl was. It's called a trony, or a sort of a character's study. And scholars debated whether there was actually a woman present, a girl present, or whether he did it from his imagination. Well, the fact that these lighting estimates are so accurate and consistent shows almost surely that these that there was a girl in front of him. And here's one way to look at the results. That red line is in the 150 degrees, and the yellow line is a cardioid, which tells us the relative probability that the light is in a given direction, given all this estimate and the fact, all these estimates, and given the fact that the yellow line is, the cardioid is so long, shows the remarkable agreement. Now, this technique can be used elsewhere in the studies of art. For instance, in Renaissance paintings, you will often have multiple actors or figures being painted, and it might be by one master and others by others in his atelier, others students and so forth, sometimes done at different times, sometimes done under different studio conditions, different times of year, and the lighting will be different on those figures so that you can detect these using these kinds of techniques much better. We've proven much better than human visual system can do it, better than you can do it by eye. So it will help to identify, we say, the number of hands in a work. And this is very important for understanding artworks. But I'm sure some of you will say, yeah, but that light in that painting was really just from one direction. Most paintings have light from a range of directions. So we generalize this to a light field model where the light described by L of V, the V is a vector pointing into an object, can differ from different directions, light reflecting off a wall, coming through a window with a candle, and so forth. Well, and now the brightness on a given patch is an integral over all those incident lights, the so-called light field, times the reflectivity function. It's called Lambert's cosine law. And I won't go through all the details here, though I'm happy to explain it. It involves the spherical harmonics. Anyone in physics who solved the wave equation for a hydrogen atom knows the spherical harmonics. And we express the incoming light with just five, the first five, the largest five terms in the spherical harmonic basis. And that means we're describing the intensity with five terms with unknown weights. And we have to estimate those weights, the coefficients L naught naught, L1 minus one, and so forth all the way down. And here are those spherical harmonics, and we're using just the ones that give evidence along the outer boundary or occluding contour of an object. And here's the math, the bases are in the big matrix, the unknown coefficients are in the vertical vector, and the measured outputs are on the right, measured lightnesses along the contour, and we estimate that vector W, which tells us about the light field. Here's some real data on Caravaggio's Adoration of the Shepherds. I've color-coded the contours around the objects, and here's the real data on the right. And these are five-term fits of using the spherical harmonic bases to those, and that thus we get five coefficient or five element vector for each one of those. Now, how do we use this? Here's a painting of Mayor Rendell of Philadelphia. Now he's, I think, governor of Pennsylvania. And it's difficult to get famous people to stand for weeks, sometimes months, inside your studio. So the portrait painter does a different technique. He goes to Mayor Rendell's office and takes a photograph of him standing. And then he goes to the background he wants to paint him against, which might be in another building, another state. And he takes another photograph. Bingo, this is the artist standing with the background that he wants to paint Mayor Rendell against. Then the artist goes back into his studio and he's looking at two photographs while he paints. But there's no guarantee that the lighting on the background is the same as the lighting on the figure. And you can't tell looking at the painting. And I've shown the not just images, but the actual painting to art scholars. They can't tell either. But this light field occluding contour algorithm can. Let me just show you another painting by Garth. This portrait of Mark Single. Here is the background photograph, the referent we call it. Here's the photograph of the governor standing, but notice his hand is different. Garth wanted to have his hand out as if handshaking, so he took another photograph of himself with the hand in the position he wants. Now he goes into his studio and has three photographs that he paints. And looking at the actual final painting, it's very difficult to tell the consistency or inconsistency in the lighting, but our techniques can find it. But we need some way to compare the weight vectors. If I find the weight vector W1 for one object and for another object W2, how similar or different are they? And it's basically a generalized dot product. So here's some ground truth. Here's a reference photograph that Garth used, and here's the actual painting that he created from it in his studio. And we used the black contour on the boy and the white contour on the mother. And then we also did it on this painting, Human on My Faithless Arm. Garth painted the background, and then 9 months later, after he moved to a different studio, a different time of year, he did his self-portrait in a mirror. So there's no guarantee that the lighting is the same on the background as on the subject himself, but it's difficult to tell by eye. So here are our results. At the top, we have the five coefficients for the boy and the mother, and they match very, very closely. That distance between them is extremely small, d equals 0.06. Indeed, the lighting is the same on the boy and the mother, and the artist can accurately represent those. But for the painting at the bottom, the coefficients are rather different, and that distance is much, much larger, 0.373. So the computer can tell that the lighting is different on the background than on the figure. Now I want to use these techniques to address what was a big debate in art history, 15 years ago or so. When you stand back and look at the grand sweep of the development of Western painting, you find something very interesting happened around 1430. Before that time, images were somewhat awkward and schematic, like this Giotto fresco portrait, or this anonymous Austrian portrait of a king, or this lovely Masolino, almost porcelain doll-like portrait. But after that time, we get paintings like this, Robert Campan's A Man of 1430. It looks so realistic, almost photographic. This portrait has a personality, an individuality, a psychological depth lacking in those earlier works. This guy looks like us. What happened? Well, in order to explain the emergence of this new art, or Ars Nova, the celebrated contemporary painter David Hockney came up with a bold and very controversial theory. He says these later paintings were optical because they were optical, that Renaissance artists secretly used optical devices during the execution of their works. And here's how he believes they did it. The figure, the subject is outside, there's a window, the artist is inside before an easel, and the key element here is a concave mirror at the right, like a shaving or makeup mirror that any optics expert can tell you can cast an image, project an image just as does a lens. That image is inverted and real, and the artist would trace it, bring it down, and then fill in details and maybe add paint to give the final image. Well, one of the paintings he adduces as evidence is this masterpiece in the Louvre, Christ in the Carpenter's Studio. And he and his scientist colleague, Charles Falco, said, the source of light seems to be outside the picture, as it must be if you use optics. Joseph and the girl, it's not a girl, it's Christ, were probably painted separately, each lit by a shielded light source in place of the other figure. So in his book, Secret Knowledge, he shows two, I'll call them half paintings, where he believes when Christ was painted, the light source was in place of St. Joseph. And when St. Joseph was painted, the light source was in place of Christ. So you have to look at St. Joseph and infer the direction of illumination. Where was the light? It's really difficult, but my computer techniques solve it absolutely clearly. The first technique is cast shadow analysis. You take a point on the cast shadow of St. Joseph's left thumb, draw a straight line, and bingo, it goes right to the candle. And if you do a whole set of these cast shadows, they meet mostly at the candle. Indeed, there's one cast shadow that is consistent with the light being in place of Christ, but it has a small moment arm, and the vast majority, most of the evidence is consistent with the light at the candle. Now, I hope you can see those contours. Those contours are of equal a posteriori probability density. Basically, it's most given this evidence, it's most probable the light source was in the middle, less likely further out, less likely further out, and so forth, like a high weather region on a weather map. And we use maximum likelihood integration to put together all those estimates. I won't go through the math, but if you think you have four cast shadows with different directions and different falloffs and different confidences, you basically, for each point in the painting, you multiply their probabilities and you find the position that has the maximum likelihood, less likely, and so forth. That's how I got those contours. Then we applied the occluding contour algorithm to it. And the computer puts in all these red arrows. So this is really astounding. The computer knows nothing about Baroque art, nothing about three dimensions even, nothing about paintings. And look at the contour on Christ's shin. The computer looks at that, measures the lightness, and infers the direction to the illumination, and bingo, it goes right to the candle. This, to me and art scholars, is astounding. De La Tour was widely celebrated for his ability to render light, but few people could appreciate just how accurately he rendered the light on something like the shin and throughout the entire tableau. And you use the maximum likelihood estimate to find these contours, and bingo, right at the candle. By the way, the candle flame is behind Christ's hand. The white you see coming above is smoke from the candle. We've done it on other paintings, Madeline with the Smoking Flame in Lacma, and it's very close to the actual candle. And one of the benefits of using this probabilistic approach is that we can integrate estimates. Basically, here's the cast shadow evidence I showed you, here's the occluding contour evidence I showed you, and if you want to put them all together, you basically multiply them and find the maximum, and bingo, right close to the candle, not outside the frame of the painting, not in place of the other figure, Hockney is simply wrong. But there's other lighting information in this painting we haven't yet used, and that includes the light over the floor. Look at the floor, it's bright in the middle, dark up the sides. What position of light source would give us that pattern of lightness? We form a floor appearance model that involves the distance, the 1/r² distance to the unknown light source, Lambert's cosine law that tells us what percentage of the light gets reflected from a given position. I won't go through all the math, but you go through the estimate to find what's the best location for the light, and bingo, it's there. It's not as high as the actual candle, but it's clearly not outside the frame of the painting. It's at least consistent with the light being at the candle, not with it being in place of St. Joseph, for instance, as Hockney claims. But there's more lighting evidence we have not yet included in the analysis, and that's the pattern of light over the bodies and so forth of the figures, not the occluding contour, not the cast shadows. And just as with the Gerbler pearl earring, we have to build a 3D computer graphics model. And then on the left panel, we're gonna put light in place of St. Joseph and render Christ. And then in place of the candle and render Christ, illuminate Christ, and see which one best matches the actual painting. The problem is we don't know the depth into the tableau, into the painting, where to place our light. So we tried 19 positions in place of St. Joseph, 19 in place of the candle, chose the best, and then compared them. But first, let me show you our computer graphics model. Now, if you study art history, St. Joseph is the carpenter, a man of the world. Christ is the light of the world. He has a candle. And here, I hope you can see the changing cast shadow of the tools on the floor. Anyway, here we're going to look at the painting from the back and turn it all the way around. And here's the alpha blend. And now here is the best image we could get with St. Joseph, the light in place of St. Joseph on the left, with it in the candle at the right. And you have to ask which is the best match to the actual painting in the middle. No question, none whatsoever, that light in place of the candle matches the actual painting best. The pattern of light over Christ's chest, the cast shadow of the shin, and so forth. Hockney is just simply wrong. Now for some of our work on geometry associated with analysis of that Hockney claim. This is a Vermeer's incredible masterpiece, Girl, Gentleman at the Virginals. Simple geometrical optics and perspective analysis tells us that we can infer where the artist was, where the artist's eye was, given the geometry of such a painting. On the left, you see a computer graphics model and a transparent painting that's going to be a window, if you will, and one position of where the artist's eye could be. And at the right is the resulting painting, the geometry, the perspective results. But if you move further back, then the painting would be different, further back, different still, and further back at infinity, we get what's called orthographic perspective. All of these paintings, virtual paintings, are in perfect perspective. It's just where the center of projection is. And you can work backwards and find out where the center of projection is, or in the Hockney theory, where a lens or curved mirror would be to get the image of a painting. And the painting they claim was done using optics is Van Eyck's incredible masterpiece, Portrait of Arnolfini and His Wife, in the National Gallery in London. And to infer the position of the center of projection or the lens, we build a 3D computer graphics model. Here it is from the side. And I've shown on the left the painting, sort of like a photographic screen. The image is going to be upside down, and you ask, where would I put a lens such that the size of the image of the chandelier corresponds to the size of the real chandelier? Of course, it's not real, it's computer graphics. But, and for Arnold Fini and his wife, and indeed 13 objects throughout the painting. This is the same as if we were looking through a window of the same geometry as the actual painting. Well, and once you have the object distance and the image distance, it's high school optics to calculate the focal length of the purported lens or curved mirror. Turns out to be 61 plus or minus 8 centimeters. Hockney and his science advisor, colleague, Charles Falco claim Van Eyck placed a convex mirror at the very center of this Arnold Fini masterpiece. The very mirror, which turned around, he may well have used to construct the image. And here's a close-up, a detail of that mirror. It's only about 5 centimeters high. You see the back of Arnold Fini. You see the back of his wife, the two witnesses to the wedding coming through the doorway. And it's clearly convex. You see the curvature, the distortion of the window, the bed, and so forth. So I and my Japanese colleagues developed techniques for de-warping an image in a curved mirror. There's a direct photograph in a spherical mirror in a lab in Tokyo, and the mathematical de-warping to make all those lines straight. And so we can rectify, de-warp the image, as well as infer the radius of curvature, the bulginess of the mirror, and that tells us its focal length. And here's the image that we got. Notice the window, far more rectilinear. This is absolutely an amazing image. This is the view you would get if you were to walk into Arnold Fini's room, stand at the mirror, turn around and look back into his room, revealed almost 500 years after this painting was made. But the reason we did it, several reasons, but one was to calculate the focal length of that mirror turned around so we could test Hockney's idea. Well, here's the mirror, you see at the extreme right, you go through all the math and the estimation and you find that its focal length would have been 18, plus or minus 4 centimeters, far, far, far too short to have been used, as Hockney claims. Here from my Scientific American article is one way to visualize that. The orange sphere shows the sphere with its radius of curvature for a putative projection mirror. The radius of curvature is twice the focal length of the putative mirror. And the blue sphere on the left shows that for the convex mirror depicted in the painting, could not have been used. Well, all right, that mirror couldn't have used. Might another mirror have been used for projection? The answer is no, because the perspective is incoherent and inconsistent throughout here. Perspective lines should meet at a vanishing point, but they do not. And if you say, oh, well, maybe he used the mirror several times in patches, that can't explain why we get these nice, long, straight lines throughout the painting. But what about that chandelier? David Hockney got on CBS 60 Minutes and told 8 million people, quote, that chandelier is in perfect perspective. And he believes that's why Van Eyck must have used some sort of optics, because the chandelier, quote, is in perfect perspective. I thought I'd check. Here's an overhead view of the six-arm chandelier. Consider 2 points on neighboring arms, 1 and 6. Those define a line in Arnold Fini's room. That line is parallel to the floor because those 2 points are of equal elevation. Likewise, for other 2 points, paired points on those arms, those define a line. It's also parallel to the white one. Likewise, this. So you see in green, the figure, the lines I've just drawn for you. If you think about symmetry, you get the same for the yellow lines at the right. And if you really think about it, lines defined by arms 2 and 5 are also parallel. So here's a symmetric computer graphics model of the chandelier. And if this is a projection, of course it is, it's computer graphics, then if we construct these lines, they should meet at a vanishing point down below the chandelier. And Sure enough, they do. Of course, it's computer graphics. But here's the Arnolfini chandelier. If Hockney is right, then we do the same construction. We should get a vanishing point down to the lower left. But when we do it, here's what we get. Kaboom. It's an absolute mess, not close to being in proper perspective, not even close. Here, to see that, one of those lines extended, another line extended, and here 15. And similarly on the right side, way not close to being in proper perspective. Turns out computers are far better than even elite artists and scholars, art scholars, in determining whether something's in proper perspective. But the real proper way to do this mathematically is to perform what's known as a homography. It's a mapping from a plane to a plane in projection space. The plane defined by one of those chandelier arms and the others. Now, if they have the same perfect shape, inherent intrinsic shape, then a single homography, perfect homography, represented by this matrix H, can express it. And we can, given those two arms, infer this matrix. But what if they have inherent differences of shape? Well, my colleague Antonio Criminisi developed the estimation method that minimizes the squared difference, finds the best homography that minimizes the sum of the squared differences. And I won't go through all the math, but that's it. It involves Lagrange optimization. And then we perform that on one of the arms of the Arnolfini chandelier to overlap it with another. And we find that the arms are 10 to 12 centimeters off, much, much, much too large to be consistent with Hockney and Falco's claim. The arms simply could not have been done using projection optics. But one of the motivations of the theory was that it would have been too hard for artists to draw a chandelier that perfectly without some sort of optical tool. Well, is that true? Here's the Arnolfini chandelier, and I performed a homography on a hexagon, and it matches quite well the bobesh or candle holders. The rest of the chandelier is inconsistent, but this is pretty good. Well, how hard is that to paint? Well, as part of my research, Nicholas Williams, an award-winning artist in the south of England, painted this chandelier, five-arm chandelier, entirely by eye. I performed the homography, and it's in better perspective, slightly better than even the Van Eyck, in some squared error sense. and Williams used no tools whatsoever, no projections, no rulers, no tracing, no nothing, entirely by eye. Then he painted this beautiful chandelier too for my research. That painting's hanging over my bed in the next room, in my bedroom. And it's in superb perspective, as I'll show you on the next slide. Except. You can't see it, but my computer analysis shows there's a statistically significant difference in one of the arms compared to the others. And I emailed him, what's going on? And he said, oh yeah, I accidentally dropped that chandelier and one arm broke off and bent out. And I said, 1.5 centimeters, 1.3, close enough. So let me show you just how excellent that perspective is. Here's a segmented arm one, basically erase the background of his painting. Here's arm two, where I segment and erase the background. Then I perform that homography, that transformation, to transform arm one to overlap arm two. But, and there it is. Notice that the pan of the candle holder is all distorted. The homography maps a plane to a plane, not something that sticks out of the plane. So ignore the pan. Anyway, now then we overlap those, they overlap superbly to about a millimeter in the actual painting. So you don't need any tools in order to get this kind of perspective proper. Now, I want to return to that question I started with in the talk, which is meaning and semiotics and semantics in paintings. And there's a branch of philosophy known as semiology that studies how objects within paintings or figure images convey meaning. And there are three classes of such signifiers. The signs, like these arrows, are signs that there were Roman soldiers who shot them, or an icon, which looks like the thing it's referencing, like this globe, but it's smaller and conveys some, but not all the details, like the icons on your computer desktop of a printer or a file folder or like that. And then symbols are abstract social agreements that, an S with a line through it refers to money. And so we're gonna extract computationally simple meanings from some Christian art, which is important in the history of Western art. There are relatively many examples, and they depict biblical episodes that bear meaning. This is fundamental to understanding the artwork, like Adam and Eve. This is not just a man and a woman standing under a tree. This bears immense meaning for a billion Christians in the world. This conveys an immense amount of meaning, and how the objects work together to help convey that meaning is the kind of task we want AI to address. And so we're going to identify the figures, so-called actors, by iconographic attributes. This is not what pattern recognition people refer to as attributes, but an attribute in semiology is an object strongly associated with a religious actor. So Christ will have an attribute of the cross or the lamb or others. St. Mark will have the winged lion, St. Catherine the wheel, and so forth. There are whole databases of these. And so here are paintings of St. Peter and his attribute, the keys to heaven. And despite lots of different styles, you will always find him portrayed with keys. This artwork, especially in religious in churches, included these attributes so that the illiterate parishioners would know, better understand the stories, be able to recognize the figures by their attributes. Well, we want AI to perform this. So we collected a database of art images with this attribute. Here's keys, we did it with others, doves, crosses, and so forth. We trained a deep neural network in order to recognize these. And here are sample results. You see that in the upper left that the dove is found, the lion, the crucifixion cross, and so forth. So we can reliably recognize these in artworks. And then we had a separate module that performed semantic segmentation in order to identify objects that were candidate people. So you see in the right that maroon shows where people are. And so here are the kind of results we get. So here's Verrocchio's Baptism of Christ. We perform our AI analysis and we find that we can segment the figures, the pink and maroon, if you will. And then over here, another module recognizes the attributes, the cross, and in this case, the dove. It's a very simple geometric task to find the closest actor figure to a given recognized attribute and look in their database and identify the figure. So this is indeed Christ, and this is indeed St. John, as is correct. Okay, well, this is simple analysis. No art scholars are rushing to use this because they can do it by eye, but it's a step in understanding the actors, the objects, and ultimately the stories and the meanings that are being portrayed in these kinds of artworks. And I want to end with my sort of vision for this field. And it goes back ultimately to an art historian from the 19th century, Giovanni Morelli. Morelli was trained as a medical doctor. He spent his entire career diagnosing people by looking carefully at their eyes, their fingers, their fingernails, all in order to diagnose his patients more accurately. Late in life, he took these techniques and applied them to art in order to recognize the hands, the authors of the works, Fra Filippo Lippi, Bellini, and so forth. And it turns out he was remarkably accurate. He overturned over 100 painting attributes by bringing this sort of scientific method to art. And I think we're at a stage now where computer technology, computer algorithms, and AI can extend what Morelli did. One way to think about it is launch Morelli 2.0. And I believe that someday every art scholar will be using the kinds of techniques that computer techniques that we're beginning to develop during their analysis, their visual analyses of artworks. Anyway, that's the foundation for my forthcoming book, Pixels and Paintings, Foundations of Computer-Assisted Connoisseurship. Thanks very much.
Great. Thank you, David. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, great, because I'm on my phone now. do people have questions for David?
I see the chat.
Yeah, I've got one question if no one else ahead of me. Yeah, great. Yeah, thanks for a really wonderful talk. So I guess my question is about this, these Vermeer controversies that have come up, and I really like your analysis of that. And I was just wondering, have you applied that analysis to Tim Jennison's version of the music lesson? I mean, have you been able to get a copy where he actually was trying to do the whole thing with the comparator mirror and all of that, and just to see how that works?
Yes. Yeah. In a nutshell, there's not a chance, not a slightest chance that Vermeer used Tim's technique. It would have been the most complicated optical system on the planet with their Hubble telescope. It does not explain some of the optical evidence in Vermeer's paintings, like those blurry, out of focus blur spots, which you would not get in his telescope. And the answer is yes. I just last month published a long study called Did Tim Paint a Vermeer? It's in the Journal of Image Science and Technology. And in 1 week, a big rebuttal article will come out in Optics and Photonics News. If you send me your email, I'll send you those papers and a forthcoming one directed to artists, the art community. But in a nutshell, not a chance. So I know David talked there at SFI last year.
Oh, so you could tell that Tim was using optics. Like when you apply your method to his image, can you do the opposite inference and say, oh yeah, the optics were definitely used on his image? I guess that was, where you know both things to be true, that he tried to paint this room, but he used optics, and can you do the inverse problem that way? Yeah.
Excellent question. We are looking for good databases of images that we know were made by the same author, the same artist, with and without optical tools in order to test our methods. You can read my paper, and it is consistent with using optics, but there's some other problems. I mean, it's not, our main interest is whether Vermeer used it, and there's all this evidence in actual Vermeer's paintings that Tim's method cannot explain and will not explain. Anyway, it's a great question. Send me an email and I'll send you the papers. I'm happy to do it.
Yeah, thanks so much.
Other questions? 2017 lecture. I haven't checked it on YouTube, but Tim Jennison. No, I know Tim. I've corresponded with him. I have his figure, his painting, high resolution. Yeah.
I have a question.
Sure.
Thanks for this really interesting talk. There's this technique in the deep learning field called style transfer. Where the idea is that the style of a painting or an artist can be learned through correlation matrix between activations and various layers of a network.
I know it very well.
What do you think? Do you think that style can be captured in that kind of statistical algorithm?
Style is a very amorphous term. There's no uniform definition agreed by all. But yes, you can definitely make a photograph that looks like it was painted by Seurat or Renoir. And in fact, we are using that not to make a photograph look like that. I don't find that particularly interesting. But to get a database of hundreds of thousands of paintings by Renoir. We only have perhaps 3,000 paintings by Renoir. What if we needed 50,000? What would we do? We would use style transfer onto photographs. So we had, Renoir painting of Santa Fe, which he never made, but we can use that for training our systems for improved image segmentation. And in fact, one of my students just did a project on exactly that project, and we're going to expand that into a paper. So the use of style transfer for creating surrogate data, I think is a real value. But just transferring it to make a photograph look like, Renoir, I don't find particularly, I'm not very interested in computer generated art. I'm interested in analysis, but that's a very good question. Yep.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Hey, so I was just wondering if you've tried to analyze paintings more in the style of, say, abstract expressionism, where a perspective is, or symbols are not the relevant thing, but perhaps emotional state. Yep.
Sure. I've published several papers on authenticating Jackson Pollock's paintings by, basically, it's called texture analysis, looking at the statistics of the splattered and poured brushstrokes. And here is where we do have, we can make pseudo, non-Pollock paintings. We get an amateur artist and say, make some Pollocks for us. And now we have a database, a small database of fake ones. And in fact, we can do better, much better than chance. It's not 100%, but very few scholars can do authentication just by eye. There's lots of very interesting sources of information about the pigments, the supports, the canvas that was used, carbon dating. There's even a technique called the bomb effect. Any paintings made after Hiroshima and Nagasaki have strontium in the paint, whereas before they don't. The strontium came from the atmosphere. So if you have a painting that was supposed to be executed in 1940 and you find strontium in it, in the pigment, it's a fake. So yeah, so that applies to a whole host. And we're looking at other, I've done several papers on Piet Mondrian, whose paintings consist of vertical and horizontal black lines, rectangles of yellow, red, and blue, the primaries, and generating new and recognizing fake Mondrians. For those of you who do machine learning, you know one of the important tasks is find near misses. Find a painting that's like a Mondrian, but not quite, near the decision boundary, if you will. And we worked with scholars at Harvard to get x-rays of Mondrian's paintings, where he put the lines in different places before he settled on where he wanted the final ones. So we used the x-rays and said, that's a near miss. And we could use those, and indeed, that helped our machine learning. But meaning in abstract art, that's a long haul. That'll be a while. But the meaning of style is really important. Like the quick brushstrokes in impressionist art supports the notion that, oh, this was made quickly. It's just captured in the instant and so forth. So yeah, anyway, other questions?
I want to speak to the issue of deep fake detection, because it seems like this is pretty much, you're creating a toolkit that is going to become increasingly urgent and important.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah. In fact, some of the techniques we use were lifted straight out of the Hani Farid is one of the leading, a good friend of mine at Berkeley is a leading light in exactly these. And in fact, it was his student and I who did the first lighting analysis of the Vermeer using the software that was developed for forensic photography. I'm interested in art. I'll leave it to the others for photographs, and where style and non-photographic rendering starts becoming interesting. So for instance, the range of lightnesses you get with pigments is different from what you get in photographs. The color schemes are different. And the way art is created is very different from a photograph. It's not, unless it's photorealism, but light changes during the day, that you do at different times, and there are a whole host. And so I'm trying to focus on art alone, but fake art is a humongous problem, an absolute humongous problem. I've spoken to some of the leading curators and conservators at Getty Institute, all around the world, and the best estimate for the percentage of art on museum walls that is misattributed or fake is perhaps 20%. This is $1 trillion of worth that is misattributed, sitting in plain sight, let alone what it's doing to our knowledge of, you know, culture and scholarship. Now, not all of these are deliberate fakes. They can be misattributed. It's very difficult. Even the best attributor, Bernard Berenson, is provably wrong in 20% of his cases. So we need these tools. And that's one of the reasons I'm working on exactly these problems.
This is somewhat related based on what you just said about how things are captured in photograph. And I actually got this question thinking about Andreas's question. I wonder how these analytical tools react to different media used in paintings,
yeah.
For instance, impasto, thick oils. Excellent. How does the capture of that impact these?
Excellent question. Most of our work is on oil painting and acrylics, but we've also worked on woodblock prints, hokusai, and intaglio printing. For those of you who don't know, it's a metal plate print where you can date the edition. If you make a metal plate print, copper plate print, the lines will have a certain thickness. But then you clean the plate using crushed walnut shells and it wears it down and that changes the thickness of the grooves, the marks. And then when you print, the line will be thinner and thinner and thinner. And so you can get enough data so that you can fit a linear fit. And so if someone gives you a new print, you can say, this is from the third printing or the second printing. And the same thing happens in woodblock prints. You get cracks and breaks in the lines after multiple impressions, they're called. And so you can date a woodblock print. And this is extremely important in Japanese woodblock printing estimation. You can get a hokusai woodblock print for $500 if it's a really late one, or $50,000 if it's a first edition. And so the commercial art community really cares about this. Watercolor, we've been working on taking away the layers of paint in watercolors so that Paul Klee put down a red brush stroke and a yellow brush stroke over top. Let's look at what it looked like before he put the yellow over top. And you have very interesting color mixing where they overlap and you have to do a lot of statistical analysis to lay them. But most of the art we work on is oil painting for the number of obvious reasons.
Thank you.
Hi. So I have more of a cognitive scientist question. And I would be curious to know, would you be able to use that to gauge whether you get kind of systematic biases in the way painters represent light?
Here's the study I want to do, and I'm working on it slowly. The problem is getting a lot of data, but it goes exactly to your question. Rembrandt is one of the greatest artists of not just the Dutch Golden Age, but of all Western art. And he executed some portraits from the figure, many of figures. We have the records, we know who these people are and so forth. Others he did from his imagination, a lot of his saints and so forth. I believe that the lighting will be more coherent and consistent when he worked from a figure than when he did it from his imagination. I haven't done that study yet, but I believe so. And why this would be really interesting is that there are a number of portraits where scholars don't know whether there was actually a figure present. And if we test those and find that the lighting is really consistent, maybe that means there was a person, an actual figure in his studio. And if not, then he did it from imagination. You have to get a lot of data. We haven't done that, but that's exactly the kinds of problems I'd love to work on.
Thanks. I mean, that's totally awesome.
No, I mean, to put this more broadly, I mean, there's some things computers are better than humans at. Face it. That lighting, lighting that are relevant to art, like lighting analysis, like some of these perspective things. Also, as we get more and more big data, we're going to be able to find trends that no human will be, no art scholar will ever have the time. We can get a computer to read, to see every painting ever created in the Western canon and read every analysis of every painting. We get, and now we're gonna be able to do analyses that are beyond what any art scholar has done. Just as computers have revolutionized microbiology, astronomy, you know, every other field, it's now, we're moving into art history.
Yeah.
Yes, Paula.
Have you, in terms of your light studies, have you looked at the works of Thomas Aikens?
Ha, perfect. I'm so glad you did it. If you have time, I can pull up my talk on Thomas Aikens.
Oh, good.
I don't want to waste everybody's time. I grew up outside Philadelphia, and I know, and my grandfather owned a Thomas Aikens once. Thomas Aikens used photographs as part of his, some of his works, like The Bathers. He would take black and white photographs, have black and white glass print plates, project them onto his canvas, trace over them, and then fill in paint. He denied it in his lifetime, by the way. But scholars at the Philadelphia Museum of Art came across a trove of photographic plates that matched the Aikens paintings too closely. And now we know for sure for some that he did. And I talk about that. I haven't done much on the lighting analysis because I don't think the lighting would transfer from the painting, from the photograph much, possibly. So I haven't done Aikens, but he's a very, very interesting and very important American painter where these kinds of questions get arisen.
Yeah, the Philadelphia Museum of Art had an exhibit on him and a wonderful video that showed that he would take an item from one scene and put it into another. And so I wondered if that changed the lighting and everything. I didn't remember that it was black and white.
His
photos
this
were.
This before color photography, of course, Aikens.
Of course, silly me.
But I am working on a related thing. Frederick Remington, the great Western painter, would paint some of his works in black and white, and then someone else would go over them and colorize them, paint over them in color. I believe it would change the lighting consistency and so forth. I haven't yet had a chance to work on Remington, but I think he, like Aikens, would be a very interesting case to handle.
Well, after these studies, you need to go not away from fine art to colorizing old movies.
No, I'm not interested in that at all. I am sorry. Leave that to the commercial world. Sorry.
It's all commercial.
Well, are there these colorizing movies and, oh, is it unethical to take a Woody Allen movie and colorize it? I'm interested in paintings and museums and art scholarship.